following announcement has been paid for by the New World Order.
This is the War Machine Rhino, the last ever ECW World Heavyweight Champion, and you're listening to Damage 365 Radio. Keep listening, or you'll get gored in half.
Esposito's Pizza and Pasta. Check us out at one of our fine locations, 930 Route 34 in Matawan, New Jersey, or 233 East Main Street in Manasquan, New Jersey. From pizza and salads to pasta and buffalo wings, we have something to suit every member of your family. Whether you're seeking to take out, delivery, or you just want to dine in, let us do the dishes, as we would be more than happy to take care of your next meal. Our courteous and friendly restaurant staff is here to meet and exceed all your expectations. We promise an enjoyable experience each and every time we serve you. Try our award-winning Sesame Crust Pizza, our recent winner at the Las Vegas Pizza Open. Visit us online at sesameseedpizza.com for store hours, menus, and phone numbers to one of our great locations. Esposito's Pizza and Pasta, so close to eating at mom's, but without all the yelling.
Hey, this is Bruce Pritchard, and you are listening to Damage 365 Radio. But I need you to know something. Just because I love you doesn't mean I like you.
Hey, wrestling promoters and booking agents. You know where you can get inexpensive prints of your hired talent? Right here at Fast Copy Printing Center, located in the Pearl of the Bayshore. That's right, whether you need 8x10s, 11x14s, posters, long format, or even weatherproof signs, we can do it all. We also can create promotional items for your business, such as pens, business cards, drink koozies, banners, or just a coffee mug. Stop on down to Fast Copy Printing Center, 81 Broad Street in Keyport, New Jersey, or call us at 732-739-4646. No job is too big and satisfaction is guaranteed. Tell them Damage 365 sent you.
This is Lanny Poffo, formerly the genius full of glory and renown. You are listening to Damage 365 Radio.
The Funkenstein Wrestling Superstore, selling wrestling memorabilia from all around the world, including WWE, Impact, ROH, Japan, Mexico, and the Indies. They sell action figures, lucha masks, t-shirts, trading cards, magazines, DVDs, autographs, collectibles, vintage video games, and more. Stop in to get tickets for local independent wrestling such as UWA Elite, CZW, and Synergy Wrestling. Located indoors at the world-famous Englishtown Flea Market, Blue Building, Booths 45 through 48, 90 Wilson Avenue in Manalapan Township, New Jersey. Open every Saturday and Sunday from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. all year round. Visit them at Facebook at facebook.com/Funkenstein Inc. New Jersey's largest wrestling store is the Funkenstein Wrestling Superstore. Tell them Damage 365 sent ya.
Attention, attention everyone. This is Allie, and you're listening to Damage 365 Radio.
The following announcement has been paid for by the New World Order.
This is Outlander Zicky Dice, and you're listening to the All Night Long Podcast.
All night long.
It's the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast. With the Enforcer.
I believe you're called Enforcers, Gordon.
I sell women's shoes.
And the Stallion.
Stallion, baby!
what you would call a handsome man.
I'll kick you in the nuts and you'll smile at me and like it.
All night long.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another edition of the All Nights Long Wrestling Podcast. We are your host. He's a Stallion. I am the Enforcer. And usually on this show, we are the only ones with the nickname. However, today, I bask in the glory that is probably the greatest nickname in professional wrestling. Lanny Locke, first of all, thank you for joining the show. And secondly, how did you get the nickname of the two-turnt party unicorn?
Took some time, but thank you for having me on the show first. I honestly don't even know where two turnt came from. I think it was just, I said turnt a lot, and I said, let's make some alliteration, let's make it happen. A party unicorn just evolved from being a unicorn to a party unicorn.
Why not? Yeah, I watched one of your matches recently. It was you versus Chris Statlander, and it was like the battle of just the best nicknames ever. Now, I know you don't know me too well, but if by the end of this you could have a cool nickname for me like that, I don't mean to put you on the spot. As of right now, I have Lazy Water Buffalo. So
Lazy,
if you have anything, yeah, that's what I'm going with. So if you have anything better than that, let me know later on.
All right, I'll keep it up here. We'll try to see if something comes up.
Perfect. Well, first and foremost, we're in the middle of Corona Mania. It is still running wild. How are you dealing with it? What are you doing? How are you staying sane?
Well, I wouldn't say I'm exactly staying sane, but we're trying.
Touché.
And honestly, just trying to keep a routine as much as possible, just focusing on the future and doing things now that will help me then. Even though it's not going to help me next week, I may not have a show this weekend, I may not have a show in 2 months, but I will eventually have another show to be on and be ready for.
Sure. Is this, I believe you started wrestling about 2014, 2015. Is this the longest you've gone without performing?
Yeah, absolutely. I haven't gone more than maybe a week since I started.
Wow. So 3 months, 3.5 months, it's officially I'm going stir crazy season, right?
Yeah. I am always trying to get Jeff to do stuff with me to do a lucha spot or just do something.
Whatever can keep, like you said, keep the mind going and just prepare for the long run. Because although the good news is it seems like we're turning the corner here. I don't know how it is where you are. Are we opening things up yet? Are we able to wrestle?
No, we're definitely not anywhere close to being able to wrestle. I think we're in phase 2 right now, non-essential businesses just opened back up, but it's still no more groups, no more people than 10 people, et cetera, stuff like that.
I do know
a couple shows in the Midwest area that are trying to reach out for June shows and stuff, but I just don't see it happening.
I saw actually Kurt Stallion post. I think it's somewhere in Texas. They're doing a drive-through movie pro wrestling. So there are two guys in the ring, and the cars pull up and watch. And I'm like, that is
that's genius. Great. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's such a good idea. It's BYOB and bring your own food. I mean, and watch wrestling. What's better than that?
They actually have already ran a show in Texas, a regular show. So
really.
Yeah, Texas, they had 25% capacity, but I don't know how much that is, how many people that is, but they ran a show.
Yeah, nobody's checking. All right, we're 25%. I'm not turning away money.
Exactly.
And Texas kind of lives by their own rules. Is that safe to say?
So yeah. I knew if someone was going to run first, it was going to probably be Texas.
Texas or Florida, I feel like, was the other one. Florida's kind of wilding out, too. I don't know if there's – I know AEW is on right now. I heard rumors that there's going to be fans there tonight. I don't know what –
Really? Fans?
Did somebody posted online that they were tested for COVID as they entered the arena? I don't know.
Okay,
who knows what to believe, but
that's
Florida's –
I would love shows to come back. They just need testing. That's it. Come on.
I agree. Now, have you watched any of the quote-unquote empty arena wrestling? Have you kept up with it? Or is it kind of just this sucks, I'm depressed?
It's just a huge bummer. Without the crowd and without the energy, it's just hard. I I think the only thing I've watched consistently is I'll watch any Kylie Rae match that's on or Chris Statlander. Like, if they're having matches, I'm watching them, but no one else can get me to suffer through a no-crowd match.
Suffer through, strong words. So have you seen the Boneyard match or the Firefly Funhouse match?
Yeah, like stuff like that. That's great. I love cinematic matches. But just in an empty arena where you're still trying to play to a crowd that's not there. Oh, I can't do it. It hurts.
Yeah, and like the guys on like Raw and SmackDown have a microphone and they're talking to the like, why do you have a microphone? There's nobody there.
Why do you have a microphone?
If you talk from here to here, I can hear you. It's like you don't need the microphone.
Yeah, it's so awkward.
I'm hoping things get back to normal soon. New York is the most is the tightest of them all here, and we're just turning into phase one, so maybe I'll be able to go back to the gym by December. I have no idea. But, I mean, it is – the coronavirus has taken so much as, you know, wrestling fans. It's taken – you know, just for Joe and I alone, we had, like, Ring of Honor tickets. We had Shine tickets. We had tickets to AEW Prudential Center and all that stuff. And, you know, it's not going to happen. I know they're you're trying to find out where to run shows and what spaces are going to allow it. Now, for you as a professional wrestler, WrestleMania weekend is the biggest weekend of the year, right? Isn't that pretty much where everybody makes the bulk of their money? So how – what did you have planned for that weekend that was, you know, not in the cards?
I was going to be – at wow, it feels like so long ago now.
it's like 3 months. It's crazy.
Texas Forever show that I was really excited to be on. I was going to tag with Alley Cat because we tagged together when we were training in Texas and whatever. So we're going to bring that back together. And where the heck else? I feel like I had like 3 bookings, but and I was just going to show up to a lot of places. I was so excited to just like watch everything too, like Pancakes and Pile Drivers. And Joey Janela's Spring Break, like I was, so I just wanted to be there, you know.
Yeah, those are the craziest shows. We were there last year when it was in 2 years ago when it was in New Jersey, and you never, literally, did not know what to expect. So
yeah.
Now let's rewind it. Let's bring it back. So now you're in Chicago right now. You said
yes.
And how you got your start in Austin, Texas, I believe, right?
Yes, I did start.
So wrestling about 5 years?
In September it'll be 5 years.
Oh, well, happy early anniversary. Hopefully you could celebrate it in the ring the way you should.
Oh, that would be the dream. Let's hope so.
Yeah, for sure. So were you a fan of professional wrestling growing up, or like the traditional question, or is this like, I'm really good at this and I want to be a wrestler? Or was it like, oh my God, this is my boyhood Shawn Michaels childhood dream?
No, I watched it when I was like little. Like my mom was a huge Rock fan and my dad liked it. So we watched it every now and then, but we weren't like crazy about it or anything. And then it wasn't cool during middle school or high school. I didn't watch it or pay attention. Wasn't even aware. But when I moved back down to Texas after graduating high school in Oregon, I met my ex-husband and he had been a huge fan his whole life. Like, he never missed a show. He went to a whole bunch of live shows. And so I started watching it every now and then with him. And I was like, oh, these divas are kind of cool. And then we went to a live show called ACW, Anarchy Championship Wrestling, in Austin, Texas. And I saw Barbie Hayden and Athena wrestle. And I was like, I got to do this.
That's, I mean, and Barbara Hayden, you know, she's definitely, she's been around a lot in the independent scene. She always put on good matches. And, you know, it's kind of one of those things where you have to be there and you have to experience it. And you're like, wait a second, I think I can do this. So
yeah.
How did watching that match fast forward go to you actually starting to train? Was that a tough transition for you?
No, I've always been like athletic. Like I played soccer all 4 years of high school and I've always been like doing stuff and I like going to the gym and I was like weightlifting before I started wrestling. So I was like, physically, I was like ready for it.
And then how about mentally? Was that tougher for you? If you were an athlete all your life and the gym stuff and the cardio that's there, it's the mental part that I think a lot of people, especially fans, don't understand.
It was just like the more theatrical part and just like letting yourself be comfortable, because it's just so obvious when you're uncomfortable. It's so obvious. And so just getting comfortable with like what you're doing and who you are and what you bring to the table and stuff like that, that's what I feel like is the hardest part of it.
And it's funny, you said it's so obvious when you're uncomfortable, which is probably the reason why you hate the empty arena wrestling, because you could tell the performers, most of them are just super uncomfortable performing in front of, like, just stands. And I think that's maybe what comes across on TV. If you don't believe in it 100% yourself, the fans are going to realize that.
Yeah, and it's like, it's just so much easier with the fans, because they give you so much, and to just not have that there is a huge lacking.
Yeah, and I know I'm not, you know, behind the curtain. I don't know anything, but I mean, you know, you react to the fans, and that's exactly how a lot of people, you know, read how the matches goes. And you, if something, you know, you go to the well if it works, right? So if there's no fans there, you're like, I think this is working. You know, it's like you,
how do you,
you can't like read your tweets live. You can't be like, oh, they do like this on Twitter. You know, it's like you just go out there and you do your thing. So that's a great point, especially for the energy too, and even for like the you know, the emotion and stuff. So, well, like we said, let's hope you know, that comes back sooner rather than later. But you talked about Anarchy Wrestling. Is that where you had your first match? How long did you train before you actually competed in your first match?
I think I was training for like 7 or 8 months, maybe. I had my first match at my training school, so I mean, if you count that as like your first show, your first match or whatever. But my first outside training match was at RCW in San Antonio. I think I was tagging. It was me and Alley Cat tagging against Delilah Doom and Paige Turner, maybe? That sounds right.
You and Alley Cat seem to have quite the strong bond over there in Texas.
Yeah, I mean, when I started training, I was the only girl there for, you know, 6 months, and then Alley Cat came along, and I said, thank God, let's go. So I was just on her, trying to get her ready for her first show so I could stop having to wrestle dudes, because I wanted to have a women's match, you know?
Sure. And it's like, you know, the not really almost friendly competition where you guys are there to motivate each other, and, you know, you do better and it forces her to do better. So you kind of each up your game, and that's 100%. Pretty cool. So.
And she was always really good, like with the character side of stuff. And like, she's been a fan her whole life. Like, she's been a huge fan of wrestling her whole life. So she knows everything. She's got a lot of knowledge up there. So it was really great to have her there for like that side of things. Like, I could bring her up on like the physical stuff that I had already learned in the 6 months before she got there, but she had like all this prior knowledge to help me out, like character wise and move wise and stuff like that.
So you guys really are the perfect tag team, because you fill, you know, you pick each other up. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Now, a lot, like I said, we're from the Northeast, so there's a lot of stuff that goes on in the Midwest and the West that we aren't too familiar with over here. You've done a lot of work with Booker T's Reality Wrestling.
Yeah.
That's cool. Talk about what that means, because I think, you know, like in the East Coast, you have, you know, your Team 3D Academy, and you have, you know, of course, the Performance Center, and you have QD Marshall School and stuff like that. But Booker T has turned out some fantastic talent in his promotion. So what is that, you know, being able to wrestle there, what is that like?
It's really sick. Like, it's the first time I was there was like an experience. Like, call time's like 2 p.m. when the show doesn't start till like 7 or 8. I don't even remember at this point. And it's just, they got two rings in the back room and then like the show ring. And so it's like everyone has all this room and time to go over stuff. And you get called in the booker's office before the show starts, and he gives you the rundown, like a one-on-one. And he wants to hear your ideas, and he'll tell you if that's stupid or if that shit sucks. And so
don't do that, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely. And then just to, like, have him like watch your match, and you get feedback from Booker T. Like, that's crazy to have that kind of knowledge like thrown at you. Like, that's such a cool opportunity. I love it there. Like, I feel like home there. They're definitely family.
That's awesome. And you think clearly Booker T, the Hall of Famer, he runs the show that way, because that's similar to what you're going to get when you get it to the, you know, WWE and the NXT. You know, you don't show up at 6:30 for a 7 o'clock show. You're there at, I don't know, 11 a.m. getting your workout in, getting this, getting that, and all that kind of stuff. So it's really kind of a preparation for that next stage.
Yeah, for sure. 100%.
So now, not only Reality Wrestling, and it turned out, I think Ember Moon came from there, correct?
Yes, she did.
Ember Moon wrestles there. Gino Medina from
Gino. I love Gino.
from MLW. See Booker T. You know, he's got a he's definitely cultivating talent down there in Texas. Now, another promotion that you wrestle with is Rise. Rise is another one that a lot of people talk about because it's very comparable to the Shimmer, very comparable to the Shine. And Rise is an all-women's promotion, and they have a plethora, I think I'm using that word right, of talent. So how, you know, how does wrestling on a show like Rise, where it's strictly an all-female show, compared to wrestling on a regular show where there might be a couple of, you know, women's matches and men's matches on it?
I mean, that aspect is like a show's a show kind of to me. But it is really cool to like be around so many hardworking women and so many women who have been successful and like are happy to help and want you to succeed as well. Like, it's just such a good environment to be in. And the fans too, like, they know that Rise is like the feeder to like Shimmer, etc. Like, they know that this is like these greener, newer girls' first opportunities. And so they're really encouraging and just like a really positive fan base to perform for.
And I think the fans take pride in that too, because, you know, you might see somebody on Rise for a year or so, and then you're like, oh man, I, you know, when she's a Shimmer or something like that, you're like, oh, I saw her, I knew her before, and you get that that like band thing where like, oh,
for
I knew
sure,
that
when like, day one. LP I came. Was there day one. Let's go.
Exactly, day one, son, day one, exactly.
Yeah.
So how now? Recently, I think it was last October, you competed for Impact Wrestling's All Glory. Impact Wrestling was doing some really cool stuff where they live streamed these events on Twitch, and they partnered with a lot of other promotions. The live stream was free, so there was no reason not to watch it, and it was such a good platform for, you know, other independent wrestling promotions to get the what are they called, like the Impact dust, right? Get the rub from Impact, yeah, just to get exactly on there on Twitch. So you, I mean, talking about who's who on the show, you wrestled Shotzi Blackheart and Kylie Rae. Like, Kylie Rae was fresh off her AEW dismissal, if you will, or she quit AEW, she left. And Shotzi had wrestled on the WWE Network for the Evolve show. So it's like,
yeah,
you're in the, is at that point, was that the, you know, the biggest match of your career with the most exposure?
Oh yeah, for sure. And I was just, I was super excited that Impact was doing stuff like that and like just giving opportunities to people to like be seen with the free stream and stuff like that. And I mean, like, I've had a bunch of matches with Kylie and Shotzi, so like for me to be in that big of a setting, it was so like comforting for me that it was those two that I was in the ring with.
And not for nothing, you also defended your Zillow Pro Women's title and won the match. Like, it's you, Shotzi, and Kylie Rae, and that's, that must have been huge for you. So, you know, and I think there's a certain level of, you know, confidence that a promotion has in you to put you in that spot when you're like, all right, the most amount of people and two champions, go. It's like, okay, yeah, I could do this, sure, no problem.
Yeah, it felt like it was really cool, like, to know that they had that trust in me. And for, like, the crowd, like, obviously they knew Kylie and Shotzi way more than me. Like, they did, there was a big local Chicago base there, but, like, you know, a lot of Impact people, they had no idea who I was. And I feel like by the end of the match, like, they understood why I was keeping the title and they were there for it.
Sure. I'm sure the Twitter followers went up after that show and the
they
Instagram
did,
followers.
Yeah.
Exactly. And now, you know, Impact Wrestling has been the punchline of a lot of jokes for a long time. And I think within the last 2 or 3 years, they've it hasn't really been warranted. Impact has done some really good stuff as far as the knockouts division. They just signed Kimberly. Yeah. They just signed Deonna Purrazzo. So, you know, somebody who's had dealings with Impact Wrestling, is that kind of is that a destination that you're looking to go?
Oh, absolutely. Impact would be like the dream locker room to join right now. Like, I don't know if you can hear this train going by, but it's very loud.
It's okay. I have three dogs that usually bark every single time.
So but I would, Impact would be like my number one go-to place right now. Like, all the women there are just so good and just such good women. Like, it'd be an honor to join a locker room.
And it's talented. And the thing about Impact is, you know, they definitely give all their Knockouts division matches time. And they have such an important spot on the card. And the WWE does too. But I'm not trying to knock the WWE, but a lot of times it feels forced. Like they're forcing women into this position, not necessarily because they think it's the right thing to do in the card, but that's really like what they have to do. Impact is like, no, our women's division is awesome. They put on great matches. So here's 15 minutes or here's, you know, 12 minutes or something like
that. Yeah, they get like real stories and real time to draw out these stories, and it's not just like a 2 week long thing. Like, yeah, they do right by them for sure.
Yeah, like, oh, you turned on me because I'm jealous of so and so, and they do it like that. It's like the Sue Young thing with Havoc, and like they really put time and effort into that. So I would love to would love to see that happen eventually at some point. I know they're doing the empty arena matches too, so fingers crossed. We'll definitely well, I hope they continue doing that Twitch and their intermingling with the other promotions. I think it was really good for them, and I think it showed a lot of faith, in the fan bases too, because Impact had done a lot to lose their fans, unfortunately, and I think they're coming back now, and they're putting on really consistent shows. Like, but, I mean, if you would have told me Disco Inferno was wrestling in 2020, I'd be like, I'm not watching that shit. Right? But then you watch a show, and you're like, Disco had a good match, you know? It's like...
Yeah.
I hope we see it sooner rather than later. Now, somebody who has, let's say somebody's never seen you wrestle before, and you are going to put together a highlight of yourself for them. What three matches do you put on that highlight?
I would put the three-way match that we just talked about, that triple threat for sure. It's a good classic. There is a really good, I would put them on me and Elena, our last singles match at Freelance. That was great. The Freelance crowd, amazing.
Really great crowd.
Much better than that. Sure. And last but not least, what else would I do? Probably one of the scrambles I was in, just so they can see like the wild shit that I can sprinkle in that maybe in a normal match I wouldn't be able to.
Fair enough. Well, I will definitely scour the tube of you and see what we can come up with and share it out there. Now, earlier today, or maybe it was yesterday, you had a post wearing a certain t-shirt of a certain Hall of Famer. Now, I want to let you know that Joe and I have been friends for probably 20 years, and there's always something that drives a spike right through that friendship. And that something is, if you had to choose one, all time, dead or alive, top five, number one, is it Bret Hart or is it Shawn Michaels?
Oh, man, Jeff's going to be mad at me if he hears this. Shawn Michaels.
Well, come on, you had the picture with Bret Hart. What happened? You were wearing the Bret Hart shirt.
It's Jeff's. He has a lot of old, cool shirts. I'm just taking pictures in them.
This is unbelievable. I mean, we've probably asked, I don't know, like 100 people.
I don't pit them against each other in my heart, so.
I do, because I'm bitter. And I'll tell you, we've had like 100 people, probably close to 100 people on the show, and I think three people are Team Bret Hart. It's
Well, if you get Jeff on the show, he'll be number four.
Well, no, I'm sending an email, because frankly, I can't stand losing like this anymore, but... last before I let you go, you know, you've wrestled so many great women out there and guys too. Is there anybody that you watch their stuff and you're like, man, I would really love to get in the ring with X?
Oh, all the time. There's always people that I'm just like, oh my gosh, we would do so good. That list is just far too long, but I feel like priority wise, I definitely need some time with Penelope Ford. Like, we've been in maybe two matches together, but like done like one thing with each other, because it was always multiple people, so we've never gotten to like really fight. Oh wait, awesome. did we have a singles in Nova? But I wasn't Lucha Laney back then. I was, so we're a new person.
It doesn't count
with her. And then I really want a singles with Blake Christian. I know you said more women, but I just feel like he's crazy and he could put me through a lot of crazy stuff, and I want to get crazy.
Okay. Interesting. Penelope Ford, I think that's a really good one. I hadn't thought about that matchup. She's Penelope Ford, somebody that's really stepped up her game, I would say, like in the last year and a half or 2 years too. So that's Well, let's see what happens. I know it's, you know, we got a couple of months left in 2020. So if we want to do like the Cody Rhodes bucket list and the checklist, maybe we can
right?
Have that on there. Yeah, for sure. So where can people follow you? The Pro Wrestling Tees store, all the social media. Give us everything.
So Pro Wrestling Tees / Lady Luck, or you can go patreon.com/ Lady Luck. And Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all at Lainey Luck.
Well, Lainey Luck, thank you so much for joining the show tonight. We really appreciate it. And I have to know, did you come up with a cool nickname for me?
I didn't. I'm so sorry. I need more time for these.
That's
things.
You know what? That's okay. You could send us a tweet if you came up with one. You're like, he looks like a hippo. I'll accept it. I'll take the hippo. So,
all right. I'll be sure to have a tweet by the end of the month for you.
Perfect. At Lainey Luck, guys, thank you so much for your time, Lainey, and best of luck to you, and stay safe, and we hope to see you in the ring very, very soon.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Of course. Thank you.